there are places on Earth that are so vast they still impress upon us the power of nature. And Canada's rich and rugged terrain never fails to astound me. This series is a record of my journey across this northern wilderness and back into its past. A history written by explorers who should be household names back in their native Britain, but are as unknown as the land they encountered. I'll be soaking up the great outdoors with its amazing landscape, wildlife and history, meeting the locals who keep traditional skills alive and relevant, following in the footsteps of pioneers who made commercial exploitation of this country possible, and finding out about the British company they worked for, which helped to define the country we now know as Canada. My journey starts here, in the heart of Canada, and the forest that dominates it. I'm here to learn about the wildlife, the plants, and the people that made this forest home. And I'm really looking forward to it because this northern wilderness is a place I've truly come to love. It's a place where knowledge and experience are still far more important than the equipment you carry with you. This forest in many ways defines Canada. It covers a third of the country. At first, it held little to attract outside interest. Its mix of trees and water made it hard to get around. The land was barely fertile, the growing season cut short by the extreme winter. It was only when explorers learned the ways of the forest, a world of small wonders, that they were able to conquer Canada. To understand these explorers and their achievements, we first have to understand the land they encountered. It calls to me deeply. It's a place I love to explore, and it has a special name, the Boreal Forest. It takes its name from the Greek god Boreas, god of the northern wind. It sits on the top of the world and encircles the globe. It forms the single largest land biome on the planet, a green crown that's bigger than the Amazon. And I'm right in the heart of it. This is autumn in Prince Albert National Park, Saskatchewan. Today, people talk of coming into the Boreal Forest to make a wilderness trip. But for the many tribes that once inhabited this forest, it was simply home. And that's what interests me, the knowledge, the skills that make you feel completely at one with a wild place like this. I love just walking here. There's always things to see, and if you can read the signs, you get a real feel for how the place works and how each tiny detail fits into the magnificent bigger picture. A walk here is an exploration of how to survive the elements, a journey into history, and a revelation of the interdependence of life. Knowledge is everything in the forest. You can see bear claw marks here on the tree, but this tree itself is interesting. This is a balsam fir, and the leaves from the balsam fir are important browse for moose, particularly during the winter. First Nations also had uses for this. All over this bark, you've got lots of little blisters. And if I pop one of those blisters, you'll see what I'm talking about.
So if I pop that blister, you'll see it's full of resin. And that resin has been used to treat wounds, for cuts, even for burns, for centuries. A simple and effective bush medicine.
There's always wildlife to see here. This is from a wolf. The pointed tail indicates a predator, and if you look closely, you can see fur within the dropping.
Almost every mark on the trees here tells some sort of story. If you look up here, you've got these nice little holes drilled in the tree in horizontal lines going across. That's done by a member of the woodpecker family. It's the red-breasted sapsucker. And what it's done is actually tapped in little reservoirs into which sap, like a sugary syrup in this tree, will collect. And then it comes along later and harvests it. Sometimes you can even see where the sap has run down the bark. This is a lovely thing that you find this time of year. See this mushroom in the top of the tree? It didn't grow there. That's been put there by a red squirrel so that it'll dry. And when it's dry, come and collect it if he remembers where he put it. Take it off up into the trees and stash it away for the coming winter.
The native species may make life here look beautifully simple, but the pioneers who explored this land had to learn how to survive. The sheer size of the forest makes it difficult to come to terms with. Get lost here, even today, and you really are in the middle of nowhere.
The Boreal Forest really is a beautiful place to explore, but there is one major hazard. The moment you step off of a trail, it becomes invisible. And that means it's very easy to get turned around here and become lost. But you know, you needn't fear the forest. With a few simple tips, you can be comfortable here even then. First thing is, as soon as you think you may be a little bit turned around, stop. Think, maybe even have a drink. Always have a drink if it's cold weather, have something to eat. It's quite often, once you've done that, your brain starts working a bit better. Maybe you're dehydrated. It could be possible you can solve the problem then. If not, establish that place a little bit better. Old timers would take moss and put it up in the trees because moss just doesn't grow there, so they could see the place. Today, we can carry something like this with us. High visibility marker tape is very good for marking your position. Now the advantage of this is we've now got a fixed point. This is where we first discovered that we were lost, and this is probably the nearest point we're going to be to being found as well. Having marked a spot, we could, if we wanted to, march off in different directions until we relocate ourselves with something we know, as long as we maintain contact to this known point.
If you get lost at the end of the day, it's better to stay put and make a shelter than bushwhacking around in the dark. This is how I make the most basic of shelters, using branches propped against fallen tree trunks. It's simple, quick, and effective.
One of the secrets is not to work too frantically. Take your time. You don't want to sweat, because if you sweat, your clothing's going to get cold when the sun goes down. There's no rush. Staying composed and in a calm mind is the way you're going to solve the problem. All I've used here is dead wood. I haven't even broken branches. I've just taken dead fallen trees. And it's not raining today, and I don't think it's going to rain tonight, that is plenty shelter enough. But if it was wet, I'd just keep piling on dead trees until I can't see through, and you'd be amazed how well just dead wood piled up like this actually works. And there is my little snug shelter. Now, a few little home improvements. The secret is that I can curl up in here and I'm away from the elements, and with a fire beside me, I'll be toasty warm. And that's all it takes to see the night through. Once you've actually committed to staying in a shelter through the night, you've taken a positive step towards solving your problem. And all of a sudden, psychology is in your favour.
Now I just need a fire. Don't make it any bigger than you need. There's no point wasting effort.
Start with a little platform as always. On there I'm going to put some kindling, some birch bark maybe, and some small branches, and away we go. Well, that's me set. Got a rudimentary shelter, the psychological value of which is immense. I can improve that now if I want to, and I've got my fire going. That's my main source of warmth, and it's a tremendous source of morale. And the key is not to panic, not to feel threatened by the environment, but actually to look to it to help you, which is exactly what I've done.
In fact, First Nations have lived here for centuries, relying on the animals and plants around them. One brilliantly versatile resource is the birch tree. In the past, I've built canoes and pots from its pliable, strong bark, but in the right hands, it has many, many uses. The mighty tree isn't just robust, it can also be put to the most delicate of uses. Thankfully, people like Sally Milne keep such traditional crafts alive.
Sally, the birch tree is one of my favourite trees.
Mine too.
And you're going to show me something new about that, aren't you?
Yeah. It's in layers.
Yeah.
The bark of the tree is in layers.
I mean, that's not easy.
Yes, it is.
No, that's not easy.
After lots of practice, it gets to be easy.
That is amazing. So what are you looking for when you look at the tree?
A tree that doesn't have too many branches on it.
Mm-hmm.
And
not too many,
not
of, these
too many
bits.
Of the knots, yeah. And the rest is purely luck.
And is there anything you have to do when you collect the bark from the tree?
You just take a knife and cut it down, mm-hmm. without damaging the inner bark.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So that it'll carry on living.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You just take what you need to take.
Once the bark has been separated, Sally makes beautiful patterns, and she makes them with her teeth.
Right then, over to you.
If my tooth is stuck on it when I'm done, it'll be your fault.
Always my fault.
She learned this skill from her grandmother.
Now look at that. That's amazing. That's beautiful. The light comes through it. It's just incredible. Now, what was the original use for this decorative work?
Patterns for baskets and clothing and whatever, I guess.
So that would go on top of the basket?
And it would go on top of the lid of the basket.
Yep.
Then they poke holes, then they put the roots
and
through that.
And sew it on.
Yeah, and then they just discard the biting after.
That's amazing. But it's become its own form of art now, hasn't it?
Sort of. They don't call it art, they call it a craft.
A craft, yeah.
One of these days, they'll decide to consider it art.
I think they should.
Yeah, but...
That's amazing.
We don't decide those things, do we?
No. Time for me to give it a go.
And how much pressure should I put on?
Enough so that it shows through. Move it a little bit as you bite it, or move your teeth.
This is quite tricky. Okay, let's see what we've got.
There you go.
We've got something. I'm not as neat as you.
That's unique. That's good. Really good. You made some kind of a flower. Maybe something native to England that I've never seen.
I mean, definitely. Definitely. This is a tuna rose.
Sally grew up in this forest, and in many ways, it's the perspective this gives her that is the most important thing about her.
The forest is home to me. I love being in the forest. It's everything.
I think today a lot of modern people who visit the forest are a little bit scared by it because of its size.
Well, they shouldn't be. Forests are disappearing very, very fast. And where there's some left, there's nothing to be scared of in the forests. I know, I grew up in the forest. Nothing ever frightened us.
What about bears?
Bears don't bother if you don't bother them. No. No, you just know. A healthy respect for your environment. That's all the safety you need in the forest. Just to have a healthy respect for the elements that are out there.
It's a privilege to meet someone who truly understands the value of the forest, an understanding that has evolved through generations. The power of nature is overwhelming in a place like this. It's big, harsh, and unforgiving. It's certainly not a place you can cultivate, and the forest is definitely in charge. Everything here has to fight for its place. It's a tough environment, and survival isn't easy, as David Henry, forest expert and author on the Boreal Forest, can testify.
David, we're really lucky, aren't we? It's a beautiful autumnal day, but it doesn't really give a true impression of the nature of this environment, does it?
This is a tough environment. And these tamarack trees, they're just amazingly old. They grow slowly. I took one and polished down the cross-section, and a tree that size, that's 105 years old to
that's
grow
amazing.
To that size.
I'm going to actually have to look through the binoculars and magnify the rings to see them.
Look at the very outside ones. They're less than a millimeter in size. The Woods Cree call it napagasi, the tree that bends. They use it for making the toboggans and making that beautiful curve in the front of the toboggan.
So what's the average age of the trees here, do you think?
I would say these trees are in here are probably averaging 150 years old, growing
amazing.
Bit by bit over the years.
150 years old, yet these trees look like saplings. And it's not just the weather that makes this place tough. Fire is a vital part of the life of this forest.
Are you going to show me something about these jack pine cones?
Sure, be glad to. I brought a branch along. There's so many well-adapted things in the boreal forest, but the jack pine kind of comes in first place in some way. The cones, they grow on the tree, and they're sealed with pitch. They can stay on the tree for 20 years, and the seeds are just as viable, as they germinate just as well as if they're 1 year old. And the way they open, they get opened by fire. So the cones carry their own fuel supply, so they don't start right away.
That cone's been on the tree long enough to get lichen growing on it.
That's right. It's probably been on the tree 10 years. There, now.
It's opening. Can I have a look at that?
Sure.
I mean, that's amazing, isn't it? You can see how well the fire has opened that. And of course, the seeds lodge down at the base of each of these scales. I'm amazed. How long can they stay dormant like this?
20 years.
20 years
and
waiting.
And they're as fresh as, yep, waiting for that fire. And then the seeds will just spill out of the cone.
So, I mean, the point is that this forest actually requires fire for its own well-being.
Yes, it's fire dependent. Yes, the ecology of the forest is built around the fact of fire.
You get the sense that whatever challenges nature throws at this place, it bounces back stronger than ever. Even when fire destroys an area, new growth soon emerges. And in these clearings, the new shoots make perfect grazing for wildlife, who in turn fertilize the land and restart the process. Everything that happens in this forest has a reason, every act a reaction. Of course, for the people who lived here, the clearings proved to be great hunting grounds.
It's lovely to see the cow elk and her calf. I'm no expert on elk, but I would assume that that was born this year. They seem very relaxed, but actually this is a very exciting time of year for them. This is the beginning of the mating season, the rut. And in the woods around here, there'll be the bull elks with all their fantastic antlers on. Very exciting time. There's another cow just appeared here. I'm surrounded by them. I love their markings. It's very good camouflage as well. These muted shades that blend in so beautifully.
A curious calf, look. What's all this then? I haven't seen this before.
I love the way they move with their head up. It's very imperial. They're beautiful animals.
Nowadays, the best place to see elk is in a national park like this, where they and the forest are protected. Because this forest needs protection. Oil has been found under it, and potentially the forest is under threat from industry. But there is a business that doesn't just live with the forest, it positively thrives on it, the wild rice industry.
Oh, I feel like at home now.
That's more like it.
For centuries, the Huron gathered rice at the southern edge of the forest as a staple food. But today, it's a major industry in the north of Saskatchewan. Tom Charles showed me how it would have been harvested traditionally.
It gets in your face, sister.
There's quite a knack to this, isn't there? If I go too fast, then you miss some.
Yeah, and you really don't want to hit the stalk itself. So what you do is you bring it over across like that.
Yep.
And when it's there, you want to tap it into the boat.
That's so as not to damage the rice.
Yeah, you don't want to hit the stalk itself because in the ripening period, it starts from the top and it gradually goes down. So with this area here, you can pick 4 or 5 times in one time.
So if you hit the stalk itself, you take off the unripe seeds.
Yeah, and you destroy it, eh?
Yeah.
And that way you may not have seed for next year. Some people think it's an annual plant, but it isn't. It's because of our... the way you hit them and things like that.
Now, of course, this is the traditional way of
harvesting. Yes, it is.
But that's not the way you do it today, is it?
No. We have big modern boats, and we drive through there 10, 12 miles an hour, and it falls in there.
Just scoop it up?
Just scoop it up type of thing.
I guess in the old days, the people who did this did harvest it this way. They'd have had a real knack at this.
Yeah, yeah.
Are you going to show me what we do with this, then?
Yeah, let's go back to shore. One last.
So Tom, you're parching the grains now.
Yeah, by moving it around all the time. It's got a little bit of water when it's starting to heat up and things like that. You want the inside of the grain to be hard, harden it up so it's not chalky or milky anymore.
Yeah.
You just want to keep turning it, moving it around in the pot.
So you're getting rid of the husk and you're hardening the kernel.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
Let's hope it's worth the wait.
Oh, that's delicious.
It is. Gosh, delicious.
Me. That'd make a great breakfast cereal.
You're going to eat up all the evidence here.
I think I am.
And this is here the more the traditional commercial product that they produce through at the processing plant.
Mm-hmm.
You notice it's all uniform and things like that. Mm-hmm. It's hard.
Mm. I'm going to eat all this. We better cook some of that, hadn't we?
We better cook some of this right away.
It may be big business, but it's great to meet people like Tom, who are so in tune with the area in which he works.
Tom, do you spend long hours in the woods like this?
Yeah. Especially this time of the year, it's a seasonal job. And, you know, you got maybe 1,500 people doing this in the harvesting industry. To get the best harvesters out in the bush is the people that enjoy the bush and respect the bush. And then learning little trades like this and listening to the elders. There's not much to say about it. A person's got to go out and experience it. You know, some people like kayaking. I enjoy doing this.
Right.
Try that.
See. That is delicious. So the texture's fantastic.
Yeah,
it's got a different flavour. It's lovely.
Yeah, this one's a little bit hot, I think.
Mm. Mm. What's interesting is it's got a flavour of its own. It's so strong in flavour. I think that's delicious. Absolutely beautiful. Ordinary rice does not compare to that.
No.
Mmm. Tom, I'm really going to have to give you a lesson in spoon carving.
Or learn how to use chopsticks or something like that. It's really good.
That's delicious. Thank you for showing me all that.
You're welcome.
Been brilliant.
Thank you for coming here.
No, it's been a pleasure.
It's the abundance of water that makes this place ideal for wild rice. It's humbling to think that 1/5 of the world's fresh water is here. Water is key to the boreal forest.
My favourite time to come and explore the Boreal Forest is now in the autumn, and mosquitoes have died right back. But there is one problem travelling by canoe here, and that is that the rivers often have very little water left in them. But I do have an ally in that, and that's the beaver. Beavers build dams in the rivers, and sometimes that's a godsend because they hold water in the river too. It's amazing. Mound to my right is a beaver's lodge, and this has been created throughout the summer by a family of beavers, and inside there they've got chambers in which they can feed and sleep safely. They make their dams to keep the water level high enough that their entrance is underwater. That's for security and for safety. And at this time of year they're just sort of completing the lodge. You can see some mud up there now. They'll start to cover this in mud. When the winter comes that will freeze like a frozen cap on top of it to protect them from predators trying to burrow in. And you know, they modify this whole landscape to create this. The beaver play a vital role here in creating habitat for a whole range of water plants.
The beaver certainly leave their mark on the landscape.
This pretty good sized balsam poplar. I'd say this is 4 or 5 hours of work for the beavers. You can see all the teeth marks here, and they're all kind of horizontal. Well, they're not after the main trunk of the tree. It's the younger bark on the branches at the top of the tree that'll get them through the winter. That's what they digest. The way a beaver will do this is they come up and they turn their head sideways, and here's one of the chips that they've taken out, and it sits in the tree like that, and if you look at it, you can see their teeth marks. basically they chew once, twice, three times at the top, and then they reach down, and at the bottom they bite one, two, three, four times if they need it, and then they just reach in and rip it out and toss it out to the side and go on to the next bite. The beavers are the engineers of the boreal forest. They build the lodge, they want to build the dam, they have all that knowledge right inside.
Beavers don't just live here, they play a part in maintaining the habitat they need to live, and that's important to understand because the boreal forest isn't just a static landscape, it's a living entity, a collective where everything plays its part. In fact, even the tiniest plants play a critical role in the very creation of parts of the forest. This is one of the miracles of the boreal forest, and despite its individual size, sphagnum moss is a powerful force here.
David, I'm quite astonished at the number of types of sphagnum I'm seeing here. How many different species do you have?
In our forest in Saskatchewan, we have 17 different species of sphagnum.
That's amazing, because where I come from, we've less than a handful. But the sphagnum plays an important role in the forest as a whole, isn't it?
In the boreal forest, it's central. It determines what trees grow on the site, what shrubs grow on the site, makes it acid-tolerant plants grow there.
One of the things I find fascinating about this plant is how it's, in one sense, it's a sponge, and yet the environment in which it lives is also very wet. How does that work?
Well, it is a sponge. It gets established in a little wet area where water might be flowing through, and it starts to grow. And there's a sponge-like structure to it that allows it to absorb around 7 times its weight in water. And it grows to the extent where it will shut off those little channels coming into the site. And then it's really cut off not only the flow through, but it's cut off the flow of nutrients, nitrogen or phosphorus coming through.
The more sphagnum takes hold, the more it creates conditions where only sphagnum can live. Other plants are eased out, leaving boggy muskeg sitting on top of the peat bogs.
And once it's in that state, it just will grow. The peat moss accumulates. The only nutrients it gets are from the wind or from the rain. And it just starts releasing acid, starts lowering the temperature of the soil, making the site more and more favorable to sphagnum and less favorable to many plants that can't tolerate the acid, can't tolerate the low nutrients. And a bog starts to form in the forest and grows out from there until the sphagnum creates a mound.
So these raised bogs.
The raised bogs, or the pulses. And it's really an organic landform completely created by this moss that is that high in its maturity.
It's amazing. It's really beautiful in here, isn't it?
A fine feather moss, fine moss yard forest.
It's fantastic. It's beautiful. Like a giant carpet. Lichen, all sorts of things peering out of the moss.
Yes. Red squirrels have made this. This is red squirrel mitten, and yeah, this is where they store their winter food.
It's amazing. And I think like they got some jack pines already in here.
Yes, indeed, yeah. They're starting to put it underground, from the crop down underground, yeah. And the whole mound is made out of shelled black spruce cones. that they've taken apart the cones to get to the seeds. And this is how they, their food source for,
yeah,
for all winter.
So they go, they actually go underground at some point.
Yes, when it gets colder than minus 30 Celsius, the squirrels can't take that temperature. So they'll leave the treetops, go underground. So it's a warning if you're traveling in the woods when the squirrels go silent and you're not seeing them anymore, you know it's that temperature or colder.
Stand still, David. David, I don't know if you know, but just behind you is actually a squirrel with a mouthful of cones.
No kidding.
That's amazing. They really are busy, aren't they?
It's an important time of year for them.
How long do you think they've got until the snow comes?
The snow will come mid-October or a bit later, so they're down to under a month at this point. They've got their work to do, just like the beavers, and mudding and building up their lodges.
I think we better leave them to it.
Yes.
If the forest is a daunting and harsh place in the autumn, it's nothing compared to the long 6 months of winter. No wonder European explorers were reluctant to come here. Why would anyone want to penetrate this frozen wilderness? Smothered in its winter clothes, I find it a truly stunning and overwhelming place. With temperatures of minus 40, it's not for the faint-hearted, but anyone who braves the elements can guarantee a wonderland. And somewhere, somewhere out there, all the wildlife, all the moss, all the trees somehow manage to survive. It's a totally different place in the winter, worlds apart, in fact, from the summer months, but no less intriguing.
It's amazing to think, just a few months ago, I paddled across this lake in a canoe. Now there's a metre of ice beneath me and I can just walk across it. It's a fascinating landscape. In the summer, you have the canoe and the canoe paddles. In the winter, it's the toboggan and the snowshoe. This is the beaver lodge that I visited back in the summer. They've obviously completed it and now it's covered in snow. Somewhere out here was their food raft, I think just there actually. In here the beavers can overwinter. They can get access to their food under the ice, which prevents them from falling victim to predators on the surface. And the snow is their insulation. Snow is a strange material. If I were to take my hand and put it into the snow, it's going to come out freezing cold. But actually, snow is full of air. And when it lies as a blanket like this, it provides fantastic insulation for anything underneath it, including the beavers. It's a wonderful place to be, though, and it's fantastic to be able to come back to the same spot months later and see it when it's got its winter coat on. Wonderful.
This cabin is a personal pilgrimage. The man who lived here was one of the first to understand the need to protect our wild places. It's odd that a place so vast should need protection.
Well, this is a very special cabin. I have to come here. I couldn't possibly come to Prince Albert National Park and not visit this particular cabin. This was occupied by one of the greats of conservation and one of my personal heroes. He was an Englishman, a boy who grew up in Hastings called Archie Bellany, but he came to be known as Grey Owl. He had this dream of living as a North American Indian here in the Northwoods, and he made his dream come true. But perhaps more importantly, he wrote a series of very important and significant works of conservation, talking about the forest here, the wildlife, and the people who inhabited it. His books were way ahead of their time, and they brought the message of conservation, of a respect for nature, into the living rooms of thousands of people all over the world. It's a very special place to be. It's very peaceful, it's very quiet. It's very of the man.
When Europeans did start to explore this land, they brought tents with them. Planning and preparation, as always, were the key to survival here.
There's no doubt this is a really pretty environment, and there's no reason why you can't camp here despite the cold temperatures, but there is a lot to know. You have to be able to read the conditions. And these conditions, this pretty snow, it's pretty awful. It's not good weather to be traveling in. You tend to sweat, you get wet, and when you get wet, you get cold. So my intention now is just to show you how you can put a tent up in these conditions. I've come into the trees, not the ideal campsite here. I'd like to have found somewhere with more firewood close to hand, but there is firewood. But the trees are giving me good shelter from the wind, and that's a help. First job is to tamp the snow down so that it will freeze and give me a solid surface on which to work. The snow covers things so quickly. You need to be very organized so that you don't lose things. So in here I've got things like my shovel, my axe, my mother shirt, the big jacket I put on if the weather's really cold, those sorts of things. Try to keep your hands dry. When people who are new to the North learn the hard way to keep their hands dry. If your hands get wet in the snow, they will get cold.
In the winter, it's definitely not just a case of chopping down a few trees and making a shelter. You can never take this environment lightly. You have to have wisdom and experience. And with those, it's perfectly possible to live here comfortably long term.
I've come out to look for firewood. Now, if there were two of us, one of us would come out and collect all the firewood for the night. But when I'm on my own, what I like to do is to come out, have a little scout around first, take back enough to get the stove going, to get a brew on, and then come back with the toboggan to fill up with the other things that I found. One of the difficulties in this environment is knowing whether wood is dry and dead, or green, or even sopping wet and just frozen, because they're all brittle. There's a trick. If you take your knife or an axe and you cut a sliver of the wood, put it on your tongue, if it's damp, it's moisture as it thaws on your tongue. If it's dry, it's like a piece of blotting paper, and that is moist. I'm going to have that small pine there for the moment. I think that'll be perfect. That's a great feeling. I've got the tent up, I've got the stove on, fire's going, and that is a very important thing. When you're tired and you're cold, it really raises your spirits. I've already got some snow melting on there for a brew. The key thing, though, is that with a tent and a wood-burning stove, it doesn't matter if you're wet, because you're going to get dry. That's the key thing. In extreme cold, moisture builds up in your clothing and your sleeping equipment, and it's very difficult to get rid of that. But in this tent, even if it's minus 35 degrees outside, I know from testing it that with the fire going full on, at ground level I get plus 28 degrees. At the ridge, it's much higher, and up there I'll hang all my clothes and I get them dry. And that's the key thing. It means that you can continue going for a long period of time. It's perfectly possible to sleep out, even in very low temperatures, if you have a big fire. But eventually, that moisture builds up in your clothing and you have to head indoors. With a tent like this, you've got a sustained period outdoors without any problems.
In some ways, it's easier to spot wildlife here in winter. There are certainly less places to hide. I saw wolf scat in the autumn, but now I get a long-distance view of a whole pack of wolves crossing a frozen lake nearby. The fresh snow certainly makes following animal tracks a lot easier. These predators can only survive because there's actually enough food for them to prey on, so it's essential that even tiny animals can survive these winters. In fact, the snow helps them. David Henry is back to help guide me through this magical place.
The snow in the boreal forest is so fluffy, it's filled with air. It's 90% air. So the snow is filled with millions of tiny little air chambers, which makes it excellent insulation. Now, 10 minutes ago, we buried a thermometer right down next to the ground. But outside, it's minus 13 right now. Let's see what it is down there. It's minus 4. So tonight, it'll probably get to about minus 25. But under the snow, it's consistently around minus 4 the whole winter long, completely sheltered from the wind. And the mice and the voles need that. That's the habitat they survive the winter, in this very stable, slightly cold environment. And the heat from the ground melts the first inch or two. You get all this sugar snow. So they have a little passageway next to the ground that they move around in, nicely insulated for the winter.
Well, David, there's the trail of the snowshoe here, isn't it? So
you bet. Floating in that nice, soft snow, that's...
It is incredible how little they sink in.
Yeah.
Astonishing. Well, I don't know about you, but I fancy a bit of a drink.
It tastes good this morning.
Let's go and get a fire on, shall we?
Yeah. Good number of snowshoe hares in here, eh?
Yeah, they've been feeding.
Yeah.
It's hard to describe just how cold it is here.
This looks like a good spot.
Yes, good. We're out of the wind.
The thought of a healthy fire and a cup of tea is almost warmth in itself.
If we use this as a seat, eh?
Sure.
We'll clear a space here, put a fire here. I don't know what the ground's going to be like down there. I'll have a look in a moment. And put a brew on. Be good.
Okay, good.
Got to get the shovel out.
To make a space for the fire, I need to clear the snow back. Now, you can use snowshoes, but I've come prepared. Oddly, a shovel is the one piece of equipment manuals rarely mention.
Shall I leave you with a shovel?
Do some shoveling.
And, I can get some firewood.
Okay.
Nice bit of dead birch bark to start the fire. That's always helpful. Really nice working with David. You can see he's used to being in the forest because he doesn't take his snowshoes off. He leaves them on all the time. Very good.
For me, bushcraft and local knowledge make a wilderness come alive. Some may say survival is just common sense, but if you can learn from the past, study the ways of the locals, and adapt to the resources and demands of the environment you're in, you have a head start over nature. Think you can bluff your way through nature, and you are sure to come a cropper.
To hang the pot, I could just put a branch straight across there and just have a horizontal bar and hang it. But my favourite way of suspending a cooking pot in snowy conditions is with a tripod, because it's much, much more stable. And so I've knocked one of those up quite simply here. And it's good in the soft conditions. It gives a greater degree of stability and control. That's good. And of course, there's water all around the snow. I just need to make sure I collect clean snow. If I was here any length of time, I'd leave these long so I can hang things to dry, but we don't need that right now. So just trim it off.
Whilst David collects the leaves from the Labrador tea plant, I employ the First Nations tip of using spruce boughs to provide critical insulation from the cold, freezing ground.
I reckon that's looks like it's coming to the boil, doesn't it?
Yeah.
Did you get some Labrador tea?
I did, yeah.
If ever I needed a cup of tea, it's now. It tastes a little bit like green tea. It's not my usual choice of cuppa, but it certainly hits the spot.
Oh, that's good and hot. Let that steep.
There are resources everywhere if you know where to look.
Well, let's try this, shall we?
Sure.
They say that you shouldn't drink too much of it because of the strength of some of the chemicals in here, but it was very good for pioneers. It was a source of vitamin C, wasn't it?
Between the choice between cold and having hot tea, it's you can stand to risk a little bit.
Yeah.
Nothing like it on a cold day.
It may be a vast place, but it's a fragile one too. The snowshoe hare is preyed upon by lynx. In fact, they are completely interdependent. It's typical of the mutual reliance of all things in this forest.
So, David, tell me about this relationship between the snowshoe hare and the lynx.
Well, it's fundamental to the boreal forest. The hares have just crashed in the over this winter, so they're down again. And it's usually the predators that drive them down, and the lynx is very important in that, along with great horned owls and coyotes. The thought is now is that the hares run out of food in the places where there's good cover, and that kind of drives them out in the open, makes them more exposed to the predators. Then the lynx and the other predators cause the crash.
And then they crash?
Yes, and then they crash 1 or 2 years later, then the predators crash. And the other thing that a fellow in Alaska has researched, that when some of the plants in the boreal forest are heavily browsed by the hares, they put out new growth that has toxins in it. And these chemicals are in the plants for about 3 years. That holds the hares at a very low level.
So how long does it take for the populations to recover?
It takes about 3 or 4 years for the plants to put out new growth that doesn't have these anti-hare chemicals in it. And then the hares have a better food source. They start having bigger litters. And we start the whole 10-year cycle again. They start having 3 or 4 litters, and the population starts to increase.
And there are other animals that crash as well, aren't there? The population, like the caribou.
Yes, the caribou, but that's a much longer cycle. I think the thinking is it's a 40-year cycle that the caribou build up and decline on that cycle.
But in a lot of the Indian cultures, there are myths about starvation.
Strong ones, yes.
This was a real and active thing that they experienced in this part of the world.
When the caribou were low or hadn't migrated back to where the Indians were, they'd go through these winters of starvation.
It just shows how everything from human to the tiniest of the rodents is interdependent in this forest.
It's true, and these strong cycles in the boreal forest just bring that out, that everybody depends on those cycles and lives by those cycles.
I've really enjoyed these days we've spent tracking in the forest here. I shall remember them for a long while to come.
Well, you know, I've been enjoying this park for almost 40 years, and it's a wilderness of intimate experiences. Whether you're watching otters or you're tracking moose through the forest, it's just a wilderness that gives you great experience.
Well, I would certainly agree with you there. It's beautiful.
Next, my journey shows what finally drew Europeans to this uneconomic backwater and turned it from a quiet corner of human civilization into one of the largest countries on Earth.
Charlie Borman hitches a ride with the Filipino Navy next on BBC Two on the latest leg of his travels from Sydney to Tokyo. And then back home, a busy day of Premier League action, match of the day 2, with the highlights at 10.